This is Steve Downs, the voice of Master Chief, Sierra 117, and you're listening to Podcast Unlocked, the world's number one Xbox podcast. Now, finish this fight. Master Chief, out.
What's happening, friends? Welcome to Podcast Unlocked, episode 526 for January 11th, 2022. It's IGN's weekly Xbox show. I'm Ryan McCaffrey here, as always, with you alongside Destin Legarry. Hello, Destin.
Bam! Hey, everybody. Xbox time. Let's go.
Get that morning shot of energy coming at you here live. Morning Drive Radio, Destin Legarry. Gotta love it. Our old friend Cam Hawkins. Good to see you again, Cam.
You guys as well. I'm back. I'm ready to talk about Xbox.
Yes, I was so happy that you and I finally got to meet, too briefly, but at least meet in person down at the Game Awards about a month ago. So you'd been just such a wonderful friend on a screen, and it was great to translate that to 3D life.
Absolutely. It was definitely one of my highlights for that trip. So.
And also joining us, a first-time Unlocked appearance. I'd been hearing so many great things about this gentleman, and I'm happy to have him here podcasting with us this week. Kareem Cheese. Kareem, welcome.
Thank you. Thank you so much for having me, Ryan. I appreciate you guys. How are you doing today?
Oh, doing super well. Now, first of all, we want to get a little intro from you. You know, where you're streaming, what games you like to play. But also, even though I'm sure you get asked this a lot, if there's a good story, because, you know, it's Kareem K-A-R-I-M, which I presume is your actual first name. But so yes. Where, if there's an origin story for the Kareem Cheese handle, because it's one of the best online usernames that I've heard in quite some time. So the floor is yours. Please do tell us about yourself.
All right. So my name is Kareem Cheese. You can catch me playing Apex on Twitch. You can catch me reacting to anime on TikTok. You can catch me anywhere, honestly. And my best handle came from when I was in high school. All right. So I was in high school. I was at the lunch table. I was with my friends, minding my business, not bothering anybody, but I was eating a dry bagel. Okay. With no cream cheese. Yes. I said it dry because I like nothing on my bagels. I like them toasted. They taste good. Good bread is life. So somebody came to me nonchalant, minding my own business, came to me and asked me if I would put any Kareem Cheese on the bagel, hence the name. And a lot of people don't know that my name is Kareem Cheese until they actually put it together and their brain explodes.
Oh, that is the best. That's a good story. Now, does that person that christened you with that, do they know now? Or do they know that you've kind of run with it and sort of built an online life around it?
Yes, they do. And they want 10% of my royalties.
You signed nothing, so it's no money will change hands. It's all you. You can't. Nobody can prove anything in court. Well, welcome. It's great to have you here talking Xbox with us this week. Miranda and Stella should be back next week. They had a couple of other obligations, which sadly sometimes overlaps with Unlocked shoot times. So we'll look forward to welcoming them back next week. But let's get started right away. We've got the big story this week, and I even hesitate to use the term big because it's just more of a kind of a funny story. It's almost like a snowball that started rolling downhill and got a little out of control. It's Dying Light 2, which is one of the first big games due out in 2022. It's due to be released on February 4th. So that's coming right up in less than a month. And, you know, they're at that point in the development where the game's basically done and it's up to the marketing team to get out and promote it and do their thing and get gamers to want to buy it. And so Techland, the developer, goes on Twitter and says, Dying Light 2 will take at least 500 hours to complete. And, you know, I'm sure they thought that, well, that's going to be a big selling point, right? Like, people are going to love that. That's going to be cool. And instead, it just turns into this sort of bizarre, not all bad, but just this strange conversation around, well, wait a second, that's 500 hours is insane. And they actually had to walk it back in a sense. They tweeted 500 hours is related to maxing out the game, finishing all the quests, endings, and exploring every part of the world. But a regular player should finish the story and side quests and do quite a lot of exploring in less than 100 hours. So don't worry. And then this turned into such a thing that they had to make a follow-up tweet to that Destin pointed out to me, to clarify that actually it's about 20 hours for just the main story, 70 to 80 for the main story plus side quests, and then the 499 US hours for absolutely everything. Cam, I want to go to you first here, since we haven't chatted in a while. What do you make of this? Like, is this just like a classic kind of mountain out of a molehill situation, or do you even want to spend 500 hours with a game?
And on Twitter, I think it was Saturday, I was like, who cares? I just thought that, sure, like, good, like, when we see 500 hours to complete, I immediately thought, oh, that's to do literally everything in the game, not just to get through the story. You know, we know that this is an open world game. This is a sequel. They're not making any sort of changes to the structure of what this game is going to be. So it's like, okay, we got an open world game, parkour. 500 hours was obviously the explanation of that's how much hours worth of content is in the game overall, whether it be main story, side quests, things like that. So for me, I just thought it was like, okay, cool. You know, we'll get the story will probably be around, you know, 20 hours, which ended up being, and 70 to 80 hours with the side quests. That's pretty regular, I would say, for an open world game. Like, you know, I play Assassin's Creed Valhalla, almost put in 100 hours into that one by doing side quests and things like that. I thought it was fine. Like, this seems like, for those that are in the Dying Light community, we know that Dying Light had a lot of post game support, multiple expansions, multiple major updates. So for Dying Light fans, they're probably going crazy. Like, they're super happy about this. But for those that just want to play the story, they can just play the story. If people want to just do the story and the side quests, they can do that. I think this is all pretty reasonable. I mean, if I was a Kingdom Hearts fan, it's still, you know, as a Kingdom Hearts fan, if the new Kingdom Hearts game is like, oh, there's 500 hours worth of content, I'd be happy because I'm a big Kingdom Hearts fan. So I don't know, for Dying Light fans, I'm happy for you.
Kareem, how about you? I mean, you've probably, I imagine, with the amount of Apex you play, I'm sure, are 500 hours into that. Is 500 hours of Dying Light 2 of interest?
I honestly think the 500 hours is a content creator's dream. Okay, you're telling me that we're going to have 500 hours of side missions, main quests, just gameplay in general to enjoy with our communities and make content. That's our dream. But for the average gamer, the regular gamer that comes home from work that just wants to play a little bit, might not want to do all the side missions, just enjoy the story and call it a day.
Destin, you're a new dad. I imagine you will probably not be playing on the 500 hour side of things, but even 70 to 80 is still a big game. Like, what do you make of Dying Light 2 being a you know, definitely a much bigger game than the first one, which, by the way, the first one wasn't small. The first one was like 30, 40 hours. So this is roughly double that. So where are you at with this one, Destin?
Yeah, there's a lot of stuff in this game. There's like the different factions that you can align with. You can figure out how you want to tackle the challenges of the world. There's the whole nighttime is scarier than daytime. I assume there's bases that you have to reinforce. There's a lot to do. But the question is, what is that gameplay going to be like when you're actually playing it? Is it fun gameplay that you're playing for 500 hours? Or is it like, go get the 3,000 pen collectibles in the open world? Or, you know, get the slightly varied alternate ending where you're wearing a hat. You know, like, it's about what does the content actually end up being? And with Dying Light, I have to imagine that a lot of that's going to be quality content. Currently, I'm trying to get all the achievements in Halo Infinite, for example. I have a lot of time in Halo Infinite, but even that's capping out around 160 hours to do every single thing in the game. I think maybe 300 hours, and like 100 of that's multiplayer, if I'm being honest.
Yeah.
So it's about quality, not quantity. So if that 500 hours is a fun and a joy for the player, great. If it's filler, side quest, fetch quest stuff, then that's a problem. And I saw one of the comments on this thread, and it's like, I don't think that's the selling point you think it is. And they have to sell the content, which I don't think they've quite done yet for everybody. before they start bragging about how long their game is.
Yeah, well said. And that's exactly where I was going to go, is it does really come down to, are they 500 good hours or not? Because, yeah, I'm at the point in my gaming life where I'm sort of by default a little skeptical of open world games, because they have proven to me so many times over the last decade that they are often packed with filler. They are not always chock full of the best, you know, A-plus content. I mean, if you were to ask me, like, what's a great open world game that doesn't suffer from that, the first example that pops into my mind is Sunset Overdrive. And I know that's a 7-plus-year-old game at this point, but Sunset did such a memorably great job for me of making every single little quest, every single little activity that you did feel fresh and feel new and feel interesting. So yeah, you're right, Destin. It remains to be seen whether or not Techland kind of earns the player's attention for that long. There are definitely a lot of elements to this. There are some RPG elements. There's all the parkour stuff Cam was talking about. But yeah, the part two I wanted to go around the table with here is kind of echoing something that Destin just mentioned from the comments of, is 500 hours all in, is that a selling point, or is that a turnoff for more gamers than Techland might think? Kareem, I'm going to go back to you, because you know, you were pretty enthusiastic about it, saying, hey, this is going to give me a lot of meat to chew on with regard to making content on my channel. So it sounds like you're probably in the two thumbs up category on this.
I'm definitely hopeful that it's going to be great and that it succeeds the prior Dying Light, because I think the prior Dying Light was one of the greatest first person zombie games on this planet. But I could just be biased. I'm a Dying Light fan. But I definitely think Dying Light 2 is going to bring something to the table that we've missed for a while. And I hope the 500 hours is not snatch missions. I really do.
It has been 7 years. I just had to double check, because in my brain I was like, was it 20? I remember it was like January or February. It was early in the year and it was kind of this surprise hit. Like, what was it, 2016? No, it was 2015. So it has been a long wait. If you're a fan of Dying Light, this game's been a long time coming. Cam, how about you? Is 500 hours, is that a selling point for you, or does it have the opposite effect?
I mean, for me specifically, no, because I feel like everyone that's going into this game knows the kind of content that they're going to want to play. Like, everyone's going to want to go through the main story, and, you know, some might do some side quests, some might do all side quests. I feel like, again, everyone will know kind of what route they're going to go at the very least when they hop in for the first time. And depending on how much they enjoy it and what other content is there, they might stick around longer. So I think that, and there's this ongoing conversation about value in our video games, like $60, like this is a great $60 package from what it sounds like, just based off of the 70 to 80 hours of doing the story and the side quests alone. So if I'm getting, you know, 400 plus more hours of content for only $60 to $70, depending on you get it on PS5, Xbox, or Xbox One version, like that's good money. If you ask me, that's a good package for what you're paying. It's bang for your buck.
Destin, do you see it that way as well? Do you feel like it adds to the value proposition, or does it kind of make you, to our conversation earlier, does it kind of make you wary of, well, how much of that's going to be a good hours?
I think those who reacted negative to this see that 500 hour mark and they just think of it as work at some point. Like, at some point, that's not particularly exciting to somebody that is just excited about a game. When you start realizing that you're going to spend 500 hours of your life in the world of Dying Light 2, I think people are starting to make the connection of, like, do I really want to spend that much amount of my lifetime playing that particular video game, right? So it's a really interesting question. When you look at some of these other games that we mentioned, like I brought up the numbers for Assassin's Creed Valhalla. On average, all play styles, that's 101 hour long game. If you play it leisurely, it's 227 hours. And I also brought up some stats for like Destiny 2. That's like 513 hours or 566 hours playing leisurely to like do everything through Beyond Light. So like when you see Dying Light and it's comparable on howlongtobeat.com to a game like Destiny 2, I'm curious, what kind of game is this going to be? Like, what kind of stuff are we going to be doing? Because a lot of the Destiny stuff is just repetitive, right? So I hope that's not the case with Dying Light 2. I don't want to go get batteries for your blacklight generators, okay?
For me, the 20 story hours, to me, that's worth $60. I'm like, that's great. The 20 hours is fine. If I end up wandering around and doing side stuff for 10 or 20 more, even better. But yeah, I want quality over quantity. And not that you can't have both, and I hope Dying Light 2 is going to be both. But I think now, for better or for worse, Techland has drawn more attention. They've kind of put themselves under a microscope when this game does ship in a few weeks, of people are going to look at, all right, well, how much of this is good over the span of that 500 plus total hours? So,
yeah. I just want to leave one quick comment, Ryan. There's this great thread about Yakuza and how the storytelling elements really make you want to complete those storylines, because you learn about the character, you learn about why they need you to go fetch 10 bottles or everything like that. So if the storytelling elements of Dying Light 2 are great and they keep you invested in the tasks that you're trying to complete so that you can learn more about the characters within this world, then I do think there is value there. Like I echoed a few times in my earlier statement, I just don't want it to be filler content.
Yeah, well said. So we shall see February 4th coming right up for Dying Light 2. Next up this week, Amazon's Fallout TV series. Remember that? Remember that when that was announced? Well, it is moving ahead. It is set to begin production later this year. Deadline reported the timing and revealed that Jonathan Nolan, aka the co-creator of HBO's Westworld, is set to direct the series premiere. Obviously, there are some similarities between Westworld and Fallout, sort of a maybe less than ideal future scenario for humanity. Additionally, Captain Marvel writer Geneva Robertson-Dorrett and Portlandia and Silicon Valley writer Graham Wagner will serve as showrunners. No word on cast yet for Fallout or even the plot, where we're going to go story-wise with this. But yeah, it was announced back in 2020 with Nolan and Joy as a partner there attached to the project. We also know that the Bethesda themselves is going to be involved. Todd Howard will serve as an executive producer on the series. Kareem, I'll go back your way. Video game movies haven't, for the most part, worked at all, with a sadly few rare exceptions. Do you think that like a prestige TV, you know, longer form streaming service situation might actually serve a video game based show better, since video games themselves, as we just got done talking about with Dying Light 2, are long. These are long format stories. Is this going to be better off, better than a Fallout movie might be?
So I think movies are not the route to go when you are making like a movie about video games. I think you should just go the television route, in which, if I can refer to The Witcher, is doing a great job on Netflix, you know, capturing the essence of the game into an elongated season that is more comfortable than trying to squish everything up into a, you know, 2 hour, maybe an hour and a half film. I just don't think it's enough amount of time to dive into the world that everybody loves and show enough on the TV and get, you know, the good base on the acting as well, to carry a movie or in an hour and a half and be like, here's Fallout, this is what it is, you got an hour and a half, and then we're not going to make a follow-up to the movie. I think a series is definitely the way to go.
Cam, how about you? You with Kareem on this one?
I agree that there's just a level of just easeability and getting everything right when it comes to a video game adaptation with a TV series. You just, with having the episodes and having like, up to like 10 hours to tell a story, then, you know, two to three hours on the very long end of the spectrum. I'm just kind of curious as to what route the show is going to go, because this is such a big world with a lot of lore and the like different factions. And I think that there's similar to like the rumors that there's a Mass Effect show coming, that is very easy to mess up. It is very easy to drop the ball on something that has so many layers and so much depth, which are like the big reasons why people love these big RPG worlds, is because of that story and lore and background. So I kind of hope that it's a great introduction for non-Fallout fans and people that just don't play video games in general, and just kind of use the Fallout world as a set piece and just build from there, because I think that would be the best way to find a success and have more flexibility on what they want to do with the story and world moving forward.
Yeah, I'm glad you mentioned The Witcher, which I'm almost through season two. I love that show. HBO's putting a lot of star power behind The Last of Us, their adaptation there, and now Amazon with Fallout. Destin, you're a big Fallout fan. You know, Cam kind of brought it up of where's this going to go? Where, as a Fallout fan, story-wise, where do you want to see this go? Because we've seen, you know, in Fallout lore, there are a number of cities that the various Fallout games have taken place in, and there are a lot of stories to tell within those. What do you think?
I don't think that the city is the most important aspect of this. For me, I think games like Fallout and Mass Effect lend themselves best to this style of format. A TV series, we're able to explore individual storylines every episode. The Mandalorian really perfected this style of storytelling, where you would go on, you would have an overarching narrative plot device that would bring the story thread from episode to episode, but you had these individual stories told throughout that thread. If you look back at Star Trek The Next Generation and just the Star Trek television show, those are individual stories about decisions that the commander of the ship had to make and the impact that it had on the people around him, right? So as long as you have that central character that the viewer is able to latch on, in the Mandalorian's case, it's the Mandalorian, and he is sort of, and Grogu, and they're able to sort of tell those individual vignettes every episode, I think games like Mass Effect could do this really well. I think games like Fallout could do this really well. And I'm really excited to see what they do with it. I'm happy to hear that so many people like The Witcher, but I want my really good Halo series. I want my really good Fallout series, and I want my really good Mass Effect series. So hopefully we're finally getting to that time, as we've had a lot of good examples of video game movies like Sonic and even Detective Pikachu that a lot of people enjoyed, and a few good comic book television shows like The Boys adaptation is excellent from the comic book, like how they take the source material and change it enough that fans like myself just don't know what's going to happen, but take us on a journey throughout that world. I can't wait to see what they do with it, and hopefully it's a good one.
Yeah, Halo is definitely number one on my list, certainly. I'm curious what The Last of Us is going to be, because that game kind of feels like the game feels like a video game of an HBO drama, and now they're turning it into an HBO drama. But yeah, I'm surprised none of you said the thing I want to see on the Fallout TV series, you know, in whatever form, whether it's like a side plot or a main arc of a season, I want to see there come to be a decision about nuking Megaton. Like that is probably one of the most memorable Fallout quests that there have ever been, and I want to see Megaton get nuked in the TV series, and then witness the literal fallout and metaphorical fallout from that. But yeah, I think we all seem to be pretty well in agreement, because I'm with you guys. It's you know, all these examples that you're all mentioning, The Witcher and Halo and The Last of Us, and now Fallout and maybe Mass Effect, that TV does seem to be the better medium to do this, because a 2-hour movie just isn't enough. So fingers crossed that Fallout turns out well. It's, you know, Jonathan Nolan certainly has a great track record. So we'll see how it turns out as they get into production later this year. All right. Next this week, Microsoft and Ubisoft have announced that Tom Clancy's Rainbow Six Extraction is coming to Game Pass and PC Game Pass on day one. Of course, Rainbow Six Extraction is a something of a spin-off. It's going to be January 20th is when it's coming out, so that's when you will find it on Game Pass. If you just decide you want to buy it, it's a $40 game. Interestingly, Extraction is also introducing a cross-play buddy pass where every copy of the game comes with two passes to invite friends to play for free for 14 days. Rainbow Six Extraction, this has definitely been a game of some, I don't want to say controversy, but some definitely spirited reaction in the gaming community. Kareem, have you had a chance to play this yet, or have you at least been following it to kind of want to weigh in on what you think of this unique direction for Rainbow Six?
Yeah. So a lot of people don't know this. I started my career playing Rainbow Six Siege. Nice. It's the most competitive game I think I've ever touched, and I loved it ever since. I used to be a Thermite main, Thermite Habana, and then I would play either Rook and Doc.
Yeah.
Yes. So, and now we're getting, you know, a whole zombified version of the game, which is cool. It's a nice change of pace. And it also gives people who don't want to be on the sweaty comp side a chance to enjoy the guns, the gadgets, and just, you know, be part of Rainbow Six. I played the alpha. I'm not going to lie to you. I played the alpha. I played a little bit of the beta, and it kind of felt, you know, the same. It felt the same, just like I was playing Rainbow Six. No really huge changes. And I'm looking for more of, you know, that zombie scared feel. I was kind of playing it and it kind of felt like I wasn't too scared. You know what I mean? Yeah. I wasn't worried. So hopefully that changes. Hopefully we get that wow factor. Hopefully they need to maybe up the damage on, you know, some of the infected. And so I can get a real, you know, extraction experience.
Cam, how about you?
I'm not super in, like, it's not really interesting me so far from what I've seen. You know, it just, because, you know, Back 4 Blood was another game that came to Game Pass day one, and this is basically Rainbow Six Back 4 Blood, for lack of a better term.
Yeah.
And I really, like, enjoy Back 4 Blood, and I, you know, plan to go back to that game as more updates come and things like that, and I like this kind of experience, but it just, there's nothing that's really grabbing me and that's really interesting me that I want it. I feel the need to hop in, but with it being on Game Pass, I mean, I won't be hesitant to try it out if someone's like, hey, let's try out this Rainbow Six Extraction game. I'm like, sure. Like, I'm not expecting to stick with it, but I'm willing to try it out.
And yeah, I think you just hit on the key here, because the reaction in the community thus far to preview coverage, to trailers, has been overwhelmingly negative. I mean, it's the Rainbow Six community, and, you know, Kareem, you're a big part of it. A lot of them, they like it as a more simulation-focused kind of, you know, military shooter and not bringing in aliens. That's like, it'd be like if Ubisoft finally graced me with a new Splinter Cell game, but Sam had to, like, wrestle, I don't know, he had to go, like, choke out unicorns or something like that. I don't know. That's a bad example. although that would be interesting to see if suddenly there were just, like, unicorn terrorists that needed to be, you know, just put down. That'd be a game.
R6
that'd be a
multiverse.
Game. Yeah, exactly. But yeah, I think that, you know, what Game Pass does for everything, but I think will be especially relevant to Rainbow Six Extraction is it does virtually eliminate that barrier to try it out. Like, the only thing standing between you and the game is your willingness to do the whatever 30 gigabyte download, whatever it's going to be. And just do that and then give it a try, as Cam said, because I have played this. I played it, gosh, last E3. So 2021, six, eight months ago now. And it is enjoyable. I did have fun with it. I think the creature designs are pretty generic. You know, they're visually, the game's not that interesting. It's not that inspiring, but I did have a good time with it. To Kareem's point as well, it's like I did enjoy it. So I think Game Pass is this game's best chance to just get people to actually get past the aliens thing and give it a try. Like, Destin, are you on the fence with this one? Are you willing to give it a go, or is it just not even of interest?
I'm not really interested in Extraction, but there's two things in the fine print with this story that some people might have missed. The first is that they're also bringing Rainbow Six Siege to Xbox Game Pass. That was also announced in the news story over on Xbox Wire. So I think that is a really, really good get for Xbox Game Pass because, geez, you said you played professionally, right? I did this series on the six with IGN. That game is awesome. Like, once you really get into it and you're practicing your angles, you're practicing your lean walking around corners, you're using your double drone, like using all the little tips and tricks. That game is just, there's so much fun to be had there. And I can't wait to see the Xbox community explode for Rainbow Six Siege. A lot of people I have seen are excited about Extraction. But there was also a smaller story, and that was about Ubisoft Plus also being added to Xbox as an app that has nothing to do with Game Pass. It is just a separate subscription type service where you can have access to all Ubisoft games. And I believe their pricing is about $14.99 a month. So if you are interested in it, whatever about Ubisoft Plus, I think this is Ubisoft testing the waters about adding future Ubisoft titles to Xbox Game Pass. So,
yeah.
Yeah, we'll see how it does. Very, very stoked about Rainbow Six Siege being added to Game Pass. I think that's a great get.
Yeah, good point. I mean, yeah, the Ubisoft Plus thing is it's exactly like the EA Access. Same type of
thing.
That's
how EA started, and look at where they are now.
Yeah, and they're still doing big stuff on Game Pass. We just got Mass Effect last week. Mm-hmm. A Legendary Edition on there. So,
well, I'm saying EA started as a separate service, but now they're just integrated with the Game Pass subscription model. So maybe Ubisoft is similarly testing the waters.
Yeah, could very well be. Because there is a point where if you've only got so many dollars to spend a month on games, and you're probably not going to have a Game Pass and a Ubisoft Plus subscription if you're an Xbox gamer. You're more than likely going to choose Xbox Game Pass because there's just more than one publisher's game in there. So it's, yeah, I kind of wonder if Ubisoft Plus is really going to have its best chance of success on PC, but they're just, as you said, Destin, bringing it to Xbox to test the waters with it and see if, like, well, how many people can we get to bite on this? And, you know, if Extraction does well, then, well, maybe we look at kind of folding it in with Microsoft on Game Pass. So we'll see there. That game is also coming up. So, you know, if you think that 2022 is starting slow on the Xbox games front, it is not. It is getting going pretty quickly. And what should be a huge year for games, by the way, we'll be getting more into that, of course, as 2022 rolls on. It's already been a huge 2022 for Take-Two, the parent publisher of 2K Games and also Rockstar. Take-Two just bought Zynga. Yes, the mobile gaming company Zynga, in a $12.7 billion deal, which is, that's like, what is that? Like three, that's like three Star Warses or something. It's a lot of money. $12.7 billion for Zynga. And Take-Two thinks it's well worth it because it gives them a chance to leverage some of their biggest IPs in the mobile space. So in an investor presentation following the announcement of the deal, Take-Two CEO Strauss Zelnick discussed it and presented a slideshow to investors. Under a slide titled "Product Portfolios Are Highly Complementary," Take-Two shows how the company's respective games and studios can be used in tandem. Of particular interest to many fans will be the lineup of Take-Two games with the likes of Grand Theft Auto, Red Dead Redemption, BioShock, and Mafia, listed alongside a caption reading, "Opportunity to bring Take-Two's console and PC properties to mobile and add new game modes." And those are paired with a list of Zynga's in-house studios, which are listed as having a, quote, "track record of successfully executing mobile game development. So I know the unlocked audience in general doesn't really care about Zynga. I mean, I sure don't. They don't make, I'm not a mobile gamer. But this does seem like it could make a ton of sense for Take-Two on the business side. I mean, when you've got these major IPs like Take-Two has, introducing them to mobile gamers who are often a different crowd than console and PC gamers, that you can bring those people over and potentially vice versa. You can get the fans who are on console and PC to come over and try this stuff out on mobile. Destin, $12.7 billion, though, still a ton of money. Are there any particular Take-Two IPs that you'd like to see brought to mobile in an innovative, smart way? Or is this, do you think they're going to be able to get you to pick up your phone at all with any of this stuff?
To answer your first question, are there any IPs that I want to see brought to mobile in a smart way? No, not particularly. I mean, you already have the GTA trilogy, 3, Vice City, and San Andreas on mobile. You can add a controller to your phone and just play those games. So when you look at the type of things that Zynga makes, like Farmville, I actually played Farmville back when it was on Facebook. You just kind of crop things and then you hit a wall with your time every day. Right. And then you have to pay for your time to continue. I hope that's not where Take-Two is bringing their IPs, but that sort of model. I don't know how you do this in a smart way with Zynga's tech. I would rather that they spend a little bit more time on the trilogy remaster and fixed what's going on with Red Dead Online right now. But whatever, I guess the Zynga partnership. Yay. I don't know. I don't seem very optimistic about it because I'm not.
No, I get it. Yeah, it's like it's not really aimed at us, but this is quietly for us. But
billions.
It's a huge industry deal here. I mean, Cam, another game that was brought up was Midnight Club, which has been gone for a while, and that's a mobile game. Like, are there any games in that portfolio that they've got over there at Take-Two that you might think, oh, there could be a good mobile version in there somewhere?
I mean, what would be really cool is if they just made a mobile game of just the puzzle game from BioShock. That'd be really cool.
Oh,
with the pipes and stuff. I'd be down for that. But in general, no, not really. Like, I'm not a mobile gamer myself either. Seeing this trailer for Farmville 3 gave me a bit of whiplash, actually, because last time I saw it was just the OG Farmville on Facebook. I think that this is just Take-Two, instead of kind of building from the ground up, like studios and companies to make mobile games for their IP, they're like, hey, let's get someone big, notable, that people already play their games on and have them do it for us, and that's what this deal is. That's all I really see in this deal of choosing Zynga, because like, as someone who doesn't really, again, mobile game, I know Zynga, it's one of the notable mobile developers, developing companies. So it'll be interesting to see where they go and decide what they're going to do with this. I didn't expect, I know that mobile gaming is huge, but I did not expect a deal this big, like with $12.7 billion. That's insane to me. So
yeah, they just had to get that extra 700 mil attached to that. 12, we can't just go with a nice round number like 12 billion. It's we got to get another extra 700 million bucks. Kareem, how about you? Is there any 2K/Take-Two games that you think could be a good fit for mobile that would get you to actually play a mobile game on, of a major IP?
I'm going to be as honest and brutal as possible. Probably not. Probably not. But I know the mobile gaming community is huge. I know, it's a moneymaker. It's a moneymaker, and they see money in it. And I hope this works out for them. I don't want to see any GTA remasters on mobile. They got to, like Destin said, they got to fix the trilogy because it needs help. They got to fix Red Dead. But no, I honestly, no, Ryan. I just don't see it myself.
Well, I'm kind of right there with you, with just one exception. The best translation to mobile that I've ever seen of a major, like, you know, console PC, like core game IP, is actually one studio, Square Enix Montreal, that handled the Deus Ex Go, Lara Croft Go, and the first one, and still my favorite of their games, Hitman Go. Those games, what that studio did, yeah, with that, the sort of board game Go turn, you know, strategy format, it just worked so well. It was such a, I could not put those down when each of those games came out. I had such a blast with all of them. So my hope is that Take-Two is going to encourage and empower Zynga to think outside the box and not just go for the quick cash grab. You know, how do we just milk this for money? Because the Go games that I just mentioned are definitely not cash grabs. They are, you know, they were pay games, which I know even today in 2022 is practically a non-starter. You almost have to be free to play. So I'm sure there are other business challenges there, but the Go games were just so smartly designed. And my personal problem with mobile games by and large is I think that they are mostly not designed games. They are designed solely to extract money from you and not to actually have anything to say creatively. And so that's like, I watch my daughter play this stuff. And it's just, and it just, I'm just like, oh, this is, could you please play on the Switch? Because the Nintendo games are actually designed to be art, designed to be meaningful games. So there is hope there. Like I said, that those Go games that Square did were excellent. And I hope that that Take-Two will give Zynga the opportunity to make stuff like that. But huge, huge story this week, even if it's, you know, not necessarily up the average alley for an Xbox gamer. Before we wrap the news here, Destin, yeah, you flagged this. Phil Spencer going on Sway, Kara Swisher's podcast. She's a big tech journalist. And Phil talking about a topic that sadly never goes away, and that is toxicity in the online gaming space and on Xbox Live. Destin, do you kind of want to sum up what Phil was talking about here, and maybe we'll have this be our last topic of discussion for the week?
Well, that's actually not all he talked about. He talked about how we need better moderation options, how Xbox is handling moderation on their platform using the Hat company that they recently acquired that sort of uses AI to do a lot of it, and how a lot of these platforms just assume that everybody's 13 and they don't think that's a responsible way to run a network. There was a quote, the point you bring up about the anonymity on the internet and what behavior that unlocks for people who want to leverage those for, I'll call them evil reasons, I think is a great learning. And he's basically saying that they want to figure out a way to combat that. But in addition to this topic, Ryan, he also discussed how many consoles Xbox has sold. And this is sort of developing live right now, but Daniel Ahmad, an analyst who works for a firm, actually said that puts the Xbox Series X and S over 12 million units shipped currently. And the previous numbers we got, if you compare it to like the PlayStation, I believe the PS5, the last numbers were 13.4 million. So the console sales are actually a lot closer than we would believe. So yeah, there's a whole bunch in this New York Times piece we might dive in on the next episode, but I just wanted to mention those two very interesting tidbits. Great to hear Xbox looking at how to tackle the whole online toxicity movement, talking about how they don't want to like finger wag or virtue signal, just like they want to figure out how to keep their own house in order. And hopefully they can share those learnings with other companies so that those other companies are able to just make the internet a better place to play.
Kareem, you know, you're on Twitch, you're streaming, you've kind of built your community. How have you found, like, how would you fix online gaming? Which, you know, it's just a little question for you. You know, it's a simple question. I'm sure you've got a nice, easy answer off the top of your head.
Yeah, 100%. I'm quick with it. So an easy answer to fix that would be to stop acting like it doesn't exist. stop comparing your online experiences from back in the day. Oh, these kids wouldn't survive in a COD Modern Warfare 2 setting. You need to address that what was said back in the day and what is said now. There's no time frame, and there's no, like, you can't tell age over online experiences, on especially on the internet. So you need to just be upfront with your community, let them know that, you know, these things need to be changed, our community needs to be changed, and, you know, banter is cool, but you need to address that. Some people just like to be mean on purpose, and it's not right, and it's slowly, you know, it kind of hinders your community. So when you're growing a community, you want to make sure you're upfront with them. You bring people in that are for each other, and that's going to stick up for one another and going to set a great example to lead them forward.
Really well said. Cam, your thoughts on Phil's comments with regard to trying to move forward on improving Xbox Live for everyone?
Yeah, I mean, it's there's so much, I mean, there's so much to be said, right, about just the harassment and mistreatment that people get while online gaming, and simply, like, just stop. Like, don't do it. It doesn't help you. It doesn't help anyone that is on the receiving end. It's harmful. It's abusive. And it's really great that Phil recognizes this and has been more than transparent about it. It's all about communication. It's like, and that's like what I think that Phil and the whole Xbox team has done so well in these past years, is just being communicative and just saying, like, hey, this is the situation and this is what we want to take care of. And this is a problem, and this needs to be, we need to find a solution. And I know that I saw something about how it would be really great if there was just a universal, like, ban list on all online gaming networks. And you're like, yeah, that would be great. Like, realistically, just speaking truth, I don't know how that could become a possibility, but should it happen? Absolutely. You know, people should be able to moderate their own personal spaces, whether it be like their private messages on Xbox Live, their friends list on Xbox Live. All that stuff should be under their control, and being able to just game the way that you want to, where you feel comfortable and safe. And I don't think that's a ridiculous request to have for everybody.
There are almost no consequences for manipulating media, for being toxic. You're actually rewarded for inciting anger online through clicks and interactions. It's a very big industry problem that needs to be addressed. And to hear, you know, somebody like Phil Spencer come out and say, this is something that we're actively working on and everybody needs to be working on independently, it's important to sort of flag and start thinking about how we interact online, because anger, psychologically, it is something that is more shareable. You have a stronger reaction to it. And there's this whole video about the anger germ that I encourage people to watch, because when you watch something that makes you angry, you're more likely to share it, you're more likely to interact with it. And that's largely why we're at where we are online, with people just doing that for clout. It's a problem. It's a very big problem that a lot of these platforms need to address.
Yeah. And what leaves me optimistic here with regard to Phil addressing it is two things. One, we've seen that Phil and the team at Xbox have put the player first. They have walked the walk on that stuff that Phil's been talking about since he took over as head of Xbox 7 years ago, 8 years. It's going to be 8 years. So that's number one. There is a good track record there. Number two, Microsoft is a very deep pocketed company. They have lots of resources. So if they want to, you know, they want to actually address this problem, and let's say addressing the problem, just as a hypothetical example, because use of AI to help was mentioned, like, maybe Microsoft has to hire a whole team of engineers who write some awesome new AI code that's monitoring chat and flagging, you know, keywords and banning those people. Let's, again, this is, I'm not
they
an
actually
engineer.
Have, They have that, Ryan. The company is called Two Hat. They recently purchased them.
There you go.
To help with moderation. It's an automated AI system that looks for conversations and when they get too heated and just sort of look to sort of address those issues. And then, you know, I assume a human looks at those conversations and says, right. Yeah. He also talked about how Xbox isn't a political platform. It's a platform for gaming, right? And how they, like, it's not a free speech platform. It's you're there to game. It's a family. Like, there's kids on there, too, that have to be considered. And he encourages parental things. The whole New York Times piece is just really, really good. There's a lot of good stuff in there about many things going on with Xbox. I highly encourage people check it out.
Yeah, I think a lot of people mistakenly think that, oh, well, I can say anything I want because this is America. Like, well, no, you're on whether it's Twitter or whether you're on Xbox Live. That is you agree to a terms of service when you do that. That belongs to Microsoft. You don't get to say whatever you want. Your First Amendment rights do not apply. So I hope Phil and the team at Xbox are indeed going to tangibly make the online gaming experience better in the coming months and years. All right, it's time for our Unlock Block Trivia Challenge. Stella got off to an early lead last week. Destin, it's your chance to even things up, and Kareem and Cam, we don't know how many times we'll see you this year.
I got this.
You got a chance to get on the board and at least be able to say that you led at some point. You were tied with the lead.
Then I'm going to be very embarrassed.
I'm going to make myself look so dumb right now.
It's
I'm going to get it right this week, and then everyone on the panel is going to get it wrong until the next every week until I'm back on. Exactly. That's how it's going to work, you know?
So here we go. We do an Xbox trivia question every week. Sometimes it's going way back 20 years. Sometimes it's more recent. This one's going back to the 360 era. Now, Cam, when we were off mic before we got started filming, you were showing off those awesome Xbox 360 inspired kicks for Adidas did for the 20th anniversary last fall. So yes. I'm looking at you here. I want to see you get this trivia question right.
Okay.
And hopefully all three you get it right. So Cole from Virginia, thank you, Cole, for writing in with this Xbox trivia question. Asks this: in the what he labels, and I agree, underappreciated 2007 competitive shooter Shadowrun, players choose between various races with unique passive traits. Class options included humans, along with three fantasy-themed races that you could choose as you played Shadowrun. Which of these was not one of those three playable races? Was it elf, dwarf, giant, or troll? Do you know your Shadowrun? Do you remember that? What I would personally say was probably ahead of its time game, because you look at now, a multiplayer only shooter can thrive. But back in 2007, everybody was like, there's no campaign. Forget this game. Why is this a shooter? So poor Shadowrun. It never quite got the love it probably deserved. I'm going to go to Destin first before I go to our guests. Destin, any thoughts here on the fake class from Shadowrun that's among these four?
I'll say giant. Giant, final answer.
All right, just rolling the dice. Who wants to be a millionaire style? He says with it's an exasperated breath. Kareem, let me go your way next. I don't know if you ever played this back in the day.
So I have played Shadowrun, and if it came out now, it would thrive. I was a katana wielder, elf user, and I'm going to go with giant as well. See.
All right. Let's see. Cam, you want to go with the other guys here and just ride or die together, or you want to branch off and do your own thing and maybe embarrass those two other guys in the process? Maybe you'll get the point. I don't know.
So here's the thing. Like, I haven't played Shadowrun, but I do play Dungeons and Dragons. So I definitely know that, like, based off these classes, it's got to be giant or troll. But Kareem seems confident in giant, and giant was my original, like, gut guess. So I think I'm gonna stick with the crew and say giant as well.
Okay, so we have a unified panel here, everyone going with giant, and I am pleased to award everyone a point. Yes.
All right.
Yes.
Well done, guys. Giant.
Play Shadowrun.
All the other things are like elf size, so
Like, oh, I was thinking God, troll. It's so beautiful. I was thinking troll because troll is the only class, at least in, like, I don't know about the extended books and stuff like that, but I know of, like, the general main classes. Like, troll is just, as far as I know, it's just, like, an enemy that you can run into, but you can get, like, a half-human, half-giant type. You know, like, giants are huge, so I'm like, how would a giant work when you're playing with, like, an elf and, like, a dwarf? So, I don't know. I that's where my mentality was at with it.
I love that our super producer, Kate, actually has Shadowrun Xbox 360 footage queued up right now if you're watching us on video.
So
I'll be honest, I played a lot of this, but I haven't played it since it was out. So it's been so long, but I do remember having a really good time with this game. So thank you to Cole from Virginia for sending that in, and congratulations to all three of the panelists this week getting that correctly. We now have a four-way tie for first in the 2022 year-long quest for the next Unlock Block Trivia Trophy. So we've got a listener working away on that trophy for 2022 already. We don't waste any time around here. So if anybody else out there listening has a good Xbox trivia question, please send it my way, and perhaps I'll choose your question for a future episode. Please send it to unlocked@ign.com. Include the question, of course, the four multiple choice answers, and note the correct one in your email, and we'll play again next week. That brings us to the end of Unlocked 526. Cam, where can we find you these days? What are you up to?
Me on Twitter at CamFinalMix. You know, doing just freelance stuff right now. Normally Ryan or someone from IGN will hit me up and have me do a preview or something. I think the most recent thing I did was on Babylon's Fall. Not an Xbox game, but you know, you can check that out on IGN.com.
You did not like that game.
No, I did not. And I was very very sad about that. I also have a upcoming project that I will be announcing in the coming weeks. So just check out Twitter at CamFinalMix, and that's where I'll be announcing all that stuff. So,
love it. Good stuff. Kareem, how about you?
Hi. Kareem Cheese, nerd, anime enthusiast. I'm Kareem Cheese G on Twitter. You can follow me there. Kareem Cheese G on TikTok as well. And then Kareem Cheese just normal on Twitch if you guys want to catch my live streams. And also, I just want to thank you guys so much for spending your time here and listening to the podcast. We love you.
Oh, we loved having you. You made the show better this week. Please come back and see us again. This is certainly not a one-time only invitation. We'd love to have you back. This was a fun show, guys. Thanks so much. This was episode 526. Thanks to super producer Kate as well for making this show possible. We would be staring at monitors, just talking to ourselves and microphones without Kate here. So thanks everybody involved, and we will see you back here next week.